I went on tour with a group called Make a Circus, and we came up to, I saw Carlo again for the second time, because he and my mime teacher were contemporaries with DeCrew or Lecoq, I can't remember who. And I was on tour. We stopped to say hello to Carlo. I went on to Forks of Salmon, where the Make a Circus had big gigs. And then on the way back, I went to the river and I saw all these fish. This is 76, 77. And I saw all these fish in the river and I said, I gotta come here. I gotta do this. So when I got the job offer, I came back and I went right to the river and I said, look at those fish down there. And a local said, well, them is suckers. You gotta wait till the rains come before the salmon come. So I got suckered into coming. One of the jobs I had in San Francisco was in the San Francisco Mime Project. And Ann Yankovic was a contemporary of Carlos. And when he was at Berkeley, he was invited and came to see our show, which was real rudimentary, Marcel Marceau kind of illusionary mime. And Carlo didn't like it that much, but he spoke to me and said, if you come to Blue Lake, look me up. And a year or so later, I did. And by that time, I had some circus training. And he immediately made me jump onto his shoulders and was understanding while I was juggling on his shoulders. And he was doing that for his summer school students. And then I was left the juggling act, which was so lucrative, but I was turning into an alcoholic doing the same routine day in, day out, sometimes 8 times a day. Wow. Without changing. I'd change things that, you know, I was a big brassy. When we played the Renaissance Fair, our act was called Captain Robbie Fitzstewart and Those Juggling Jews, because I could talk louder than anybody. And so I was doing the patter in the show, and I was tired of it. And I wanted to play the fool. I wanted to be the silent. I wanted to be the person that's discovered in the audience, you know, kind of Pierrot-like, wandering through the juggling and trying to touch the clubs as they go by. And whenever I did that, the hat would go down. Mm-hmm. We would lose money. And Billy Kessler, who had a really working class, and Merle had a working class point of view on juggling, said, you know, I'm paying for your acting school. We're losing $300 a show so that you can act. So I quit, and I got picked up and recruited by the guy Ronnie Davis. He was the originator of the mime troupe, and he had a company called Epic West. And I did a Molière play there, Imaginary Invalid. Jay loved it. And he brought Joan. Joan liked it. So then Joan and Michael were playing at the Mission, Plaza de la Raza on Mission Street. They were playing Loon's Rage. And an old friend of mine, my roommate, what was his name? Jason. Sorry. Rub, rub. Anyway, Jason was in the show, and unbeknownst to me, he'd become drug-addled, and he was dangerous, and he was playing with a cane and high, and he struck our musician, Joyce. And I wasn't in the company yet, but Michael was chewing Jason out, and I walked up to the argument, and I said, whoa, this is my kung fu now. Chill out. Let's all take a moment and breathe together. And Michael's like, toot. Who is this guy? So then his wife was there, Ginny. And I said, oh, hello. He was going to kill me. And as I say in the bio scraps I sent you, I got into the company despite all that. He was funny right away. Even when he was mad at me, he was kind of, tense in a Jesuit kind of way. He had a thing, you know, when he would explain something, he would say, "I believe that it's very important that we follow this one track. This is our true path." Really intense. And it brought out the sort of bullshitter, the lazy braggart that in me, so that I could play off him on stage. And we just laughed a lot at each other's antics in rehearsal. And with Joan and Michael, what I realized is that you had to really practice to know your lines and what the blocking was, and then the real imaginative play could happen. That's one of the things I want to say about both of them, is that we could all live our conservative personal lives, but when we walked into rehearsal and warmed up, anything went. Gender roles were up in the air. Histories were made up. Passes and sexual politics, you name it. And it was liberating. It was liberating in a way that I never found in the mime troupe. Joan I actually knew of before, because she was in a company called the Firehouse, transplanted to San Francisco from Minneapolis. And they did a show I saw called Stab and Dance. Very psychological, deep inner turmoil. It was really kind of hard to watch, but she could dance. She could move. Michael and I did a short from Stan Laurel that he had written for, he and Ollie, in the 53 for Music Hall, and it was called Birds of a Feather, and it was a hit. Michael and I upgraded our characters. We didn't play Stan and Ollie. We played Lloyd and the Captain. And mostly Joan and I and Michael had extreme fun playing for each other. And then we'd play, you know, the chainsaw eating contest or the breakfast at the Samoa Cookhouse. And local people liked it too. And we took it to San Francisco. It was a hit. It was our first really good hit. We played North Beach. We took it all over.
Maybe talk to us a bit about like how you guys created together, like the four of you, Jael, Joan, Michael, and you, like what that process looked like. And of course, other people came and went and worked with you as well, but kind of what was the core of your creation process?
Yeah, and was that first piece that you created, was that the Intrigue at Apa? Was that the first?
No. The first piece we created collectively was Intrigue at Apa. That first piece, the only original piece, was Joan's Sugar Junkie, in which she introduced the character of Scar Tissue. And Michael and I wrote the dialogue, but it was really based on what the Stan Laurel skit was called Birds of a Feather, and we called ours Whiskey Tasters. So it was taking stuff that existed. When we worked, we had a dramaturg in those days, Steve Most, who had, with Joan Holden and Jael, had written that first Loon's Rage play that I had seen playing in the Mission. And Steve brought us an idea of concentrating on water and the theft of water. And for Joan and I, we were already deeply into fishing, knew the Klamath backwards and forwards, knew the spot that Steve had a contract named Margaret, can't remember her last name, But she had the land at APA and was a rebel. Margaret McDonald. Anyway, so we started with this concept that the only people, there was all, it was 1978, and there was this giant war about salmon at the mouth. The Secretary of State, Cecil Andrews, came to try and put the Indians back in their place, so he said. And we all took different parts of this puzzle. And Steve's was fairly academic, because he had asked for the water plan from the Bureau of Land and Reclamation, BLM? Anyway, Bureau of Land and Bureau of Land Management. And on the FOIA, Freedom of Information Act, they sent him back a map that showed these vast reservoirs inundating Hoopa and other tribal lands that they really didn't have the agency to flood. And we kind of came up with this strategy because the sportsmen were angry at the gillnetters, and the commercial fishermen would say, you know, they're killing the habitat. And the only people who had a right to protect the salmon as a resource were the Indians, because they were guaranteed fish as long as the rivers flow and the grass shall grow. That's the language of their treaty. And so we wrote a play with the object of championing Indian water rights. That's the object. We started in, and it turned into Dashiell Hammett. We used that character scar tissue, and we would write different scenes for ourselves. Joan and I wrote the salmon song, and it turned into a mini play in itself. Just man and a woman fishing on a creek, and then falling in love, and talking about their lures and sexual double entendre. What do you got there? Why, ma'am, it's a big wobbler. You know, it's my lure. We wrote things and then brought them in, passed them off. It got changed, added. Jail was a master at nurturing people to accept criticism from him and colleagues. So I would write a scene about deep trout spilling the beans, played as a fish. And J.L. said, oh, that's a good start. Let's see what Joan does with it. You just can't imagine in today's hypersensitivity somebody taking somebody else's baby and giving it to another member and saying, why don't you take a turn and see what you come up with this? But we did, because we could all give over to J.L. Years later, when he left the company, we had a hard time giving over to one another. But while he was there, it was a magic time. I remember when we did, what did I tell you once, David? We did slapstick, and all we got together, and we didn't have a dramaturg anymore. It was just five people writing. I forget who the fifth was. It was J.L., Joan, Michael, and I. And I think we hired Michelle, a woman from the Lilla Theater Company. And all he had is Joan thought it would be good to do something about the generational aspect of family violence. Michael said, I think he was booking the company at this time, said, and you remember this, David, I think bookers would like to know what we mean when we say 21st century commedia. J.L. said, I think the violent aspect, tit for tat, that we see in vaudeville would be fertile ground for us to ply. And I just wanted to do my plank routine. I had a plank routine that was very funny from the Pickles. And so we did this play, and it turned out to be our last, maybe, I was going to say our last really good play with J.L. at the helm. But we did Mad Love, too, and that worked out pretty well. But this slapstick was outrageous. The one thing I think I've been able to change in my life as a performer, and it's hard to change the basic toolkit that you come to the work with, is there was a woman in my first play in Manhattan named Sally Sommer, and she said, "Donald, you're so tense. I'm afraid when I go near you on stage, you're going to break me." And I loved her. And I took that to heart. And I've tried to relax. And then I got into this juggling act where I had to be the bully. I've tried to play, you know, the simpler characters, the newsboy, Woody, one of my favorite characters. When we were riding the top of that explosion in about 88 or 89, we hosted the new vaudeville festival and got to hire all of our friends, everybody, to work. I don't see that same new vaudeville as an entity anymore. I see our legacy as actor-created stuff, where an actor is brought into a role, even though we don't work on this model anymore, and the raw script is a launching point, and that actors are trained to work with designers, writers, lighters. That was one of Spike's greatest things. I don't know many other lighting designers who worked with actors to develop material. I was lucky. I had an opportunity while we were doing that famous play, Intrigue at APA, to go to New York and be part of the cast of Saturday Night Live. We were the hottest thing. As Peter Kors recalls, it was like being in the Beatles touring Hollywood. And the producer wanted me to leave in 2 days. I said I couldn't do that. I can't leave my company without 2 weeks' notice. Oh, come on. That was when Elliot Gould announced to the world he was taking over Saturday Night Live with an all-new, taking over from those first guys, the primetime players, taking over from Lorne Michaels, and he was going to produce an all-new ensemble company. They bombed so bad, they didn't have them back for a second Saturday night. That was a stroke.
So you dodged.
It was a stroke to be able to come to Blue Lake, raise a family. I came here last night and I watched my son perform. Come on. Goosebumps. That's my badge of when something's good. See the goosebumps? We were lucky. We got to be our essential selves. Control for a long time our means of production and put a good product out. The group of people brought together to investigate plays, community problems, were fierce, and it was because we had this old mode of theater, shamanistic, where we'd grapple with a problem, struggle with it, essentialize it, distill it, and then share the yield. And we were fearless, and the people that we worked with were fearless, and we went into scary situations, and we took leaps of faith. Joan called it the salto mortale, the leap of death. It wasn't a physical trick. It was the idea of going out on tour and having your future and livelihood and well-being and your ability to make a family and buy a house hang on a thread of people liking your play. Yeah. I think we were courageous in investigation and in experimentation. As I said before, there were no boundaries when we got to the rehearsal hall. People could throw out anything and people would try it. Let's see, can you jump up in the air, run with your feet, and then make an exit like a cartoon does? You know, I can try.